Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Alternative History of Britain, The War of the Roses, by Timothy Venning, narrated by Liam Gerrard. Introduction. The final 30 years of the Plantagenet dynasty, a surname for the family incidentally invented by Richard, Duke of York, and his supporters in the 1450s, to emphasise their superior dynastic lineage to their rivals, was an unprecedented era of political instability in England. In previous centuries, the smooth, or not, transfer of power from each monarch to his son or brother, usually his own choice as heir, had been broken only once when childless and autocratic 32-year-old Richard II was overthrown in an invasion by his cousin, Henry of Bolingbroke, Henry IV, in 1399. Henry had claimed to be Richard's rightful heir, as son of the next senior male offspring of Edward III to leave a male heir. Edward's third surviving son, Duke John of Lancaster, John of Gaunt. But his election by an assembly of nobles excluded the rights of Edmund Mortimer, the grandson, daughter's son of Edward III's second son, Duke Lionel of Clarence, who was only a child at the time, so his accession would have led to the instability of a regency. Indeed, Edmund's claim was not even tested at the election. The Salic law theory that a woman could not inherit or transmit rights to a throne did not apply in England. The feeling that Edmund had been cheated by the illegal usurpation of Henry's Lancastrian line led to assorted plots and rebellions in his name under Henry IV, and later an attempt to murder Henry V. But then these faded away as the Lancastrian throne became more secure and led a successful war to pursue its rights to the throne of France, which ironically relied on the legality of succession via a female line, namely Edward III's mother, Isabella. But the incapacity and misjudgments of the unwarlike and allegedly unworldly Henry VI and his coterie of favourites led to renewed dynastic challenges after the humiliating loss of France in 1450-53. As we shall see, this was largely stimulated by the exclusion of powerful nobles from decision-making at court and the fruits of office by Henry's clique, led by the junior Lancastrian line of Beaufort, and was thus politically opportunistic. Dynastic luck and the shifting sands of politics resulted in the current heir of Edmund Mortimer's line, his sister Anne's son Duke Richard of York, being the leader of the politico-military opposition to Henry VI's disastrous governance in the 1440s and early 1450s, excluded from power and seemingly under threat of elimination like the king's late uncle Duke Humphrey of Gloucester. Thus a mixture of ambition and self-preservation determined his struggle for influence with the king's favourites in 1450-55, a political bid for power over an increasingly feeble and once catatonic king, rather than a dynastic challenge, although his role as a potential heir also implied the latter. It was as much a case of storming the closet, as 18th-century politics called a bid by frustrated opposition figures to force their admission to office, and perks on a reluctant king, as a dynastic coup. The drastic way in which York secured this on the battlefield at St Albans in 1455, and his choice to physically eliminate the king's closest advisers in the process, then turned it into a vendetta between his party, led by his family and the Nevilles, and the king and queen's court faction led by the Beauforts and Percys. But York's initial sights were set on the heirship to the king, in place of his infant son, who was soon being claimed to be a bastard by the Yorkists, rather than a direct claim on the throne. The latter was only made after York and his allies had been driven into exile and stripped of their lands by the Queen's faction in 1459, fought their way back to power in 1460, and seized the king. Even then, most of his own supporters were opposed to his claim to be rightful king, which had to be halted, and Henry's deposition only followed the next round of the vendetta, when the Queen's men attacked and killed York and other nobles at Wakefield in December 1460. But York's son Edward IV successfully fought back. Edward IV's disputed election was then followed by victory on the battlefield of Towton, the elimination of more of Henry's allies, and eventually the capture of Henry and the flight of Queen Margaret to France. Seemingly routed for good, Henry's faction then had an unexpected stroke of luck as Edward quarrelled with his cousin and chief backer Richard Neville, Earl of Warwick, who killed his chief rivals and arrested the king in 1469, backed down from deposing him, but was driven out of England by Edward in 1470, and in retaliation invaded to restore Henry VI. The unlikely alliance of Warwick with Queen Margaret, the woman responsible for the deaths of his father and brother, was then overthrown by the returning Edward in March to May 1471. But Edward died aged 40 in 1483, and his son Edward V was then deposed as a bastard by his brother Richard III. Richard, the most controversial monarch in English history, then faced the implacable hostility of many of his late brother's loyalists, who lined up with a seemingly insignificant Beaufort Sion, Henry Tudor, and other die-hard Lancastrians to overthrow him in August 1485. The crown thus changed hands unexpectedly 6 times in 1461-85, and nearly did so again in a Yorkist invasion in 1487. Kings were deposed, murdered or not, died in suspicious circumstances, or were killed in battle. The senior nobility were destroyed by deaths in battle and political executions, and high politics seemed dominated by unsavoury and violent blood feuds. Not surprisingly, this era has provided a rich field for writers since the days of Shakespeare, and is still a favourite for romantic historical fiction, usually centred on Richard III in modern times. Recent contributors have included Rosemary Hawley Jarman, Josephine Tay, Sharon Penman and Philippa Gregory, and TV programmes include A Trial of Richard III on Channel 4. Was he really a child-murdering psychopath, a self-preserving political strategist who went too far, or an honourable and misjudged figure smeared by Tudor spin doctors? The influence of fiction on the popular conception of the period indeed includes the very concept of a War of the Roses, not a contemporary term, but thought up by Sir Walter Scott in his novel Anne of Gerstein in 1829. The first serious historical novel about the period, Last of the Barons, by Edward Bulwer-Lytton in 1843, introduced the concept of Warwick the Kingmaker, and of Edward IV as a smooth-talking lecher, whose secret betrothal, marriage, circa 1462, is still a topic of controversy. In reality, the idea of a White Rose, York, and a Red Rose, Lancaster, faction, which Shakespeare peddled in the 1590s, comes from the retrospective viewpoint of post-1485 chroniclers, who celebrated the marriage of Henry Tudor and Edward IV's daughter, Elizabeth, as uniting the two heraldic roses of their families. As the Plantagenet surname was a propaganda invention of 1450s Yorkists who revived the personal sobriquet of Henry II's father Geoffrey, so the notion of a self-proclaimed Tudor dynasty is inaccurate. Henry VII usually called himself Richmond after his earldom. But what is not at issue is that a remarkable degree of political instability, some of it self-generating, and changes of fortune saw control of power shift with the results of political alliances, chancy battles, kingly mental breakdown, and sudden royal deaths, natural or not. The issue arises, how easily could things have turned out differently? What if York had been able to secure political power in the 1450s without removing Henry VI or his son? Or he had not been killed by the Queen's men in 1460? What if Edward IV had never broken with Warwick, been deposed or killed by him in 1469-70, or had failed to regain power in 1471? What if Edward had not unexpectedly died in 1483, his son's advisers had fought off the challenge of Duke Richard of Gloucester, or Richard had won the Battle of Bosworth? This study seeks to explore some of these very real possibilities. Chapter 1. Before 1453, Henry's degree of culpability, holy or incompetent. The intense turbulence and political reversals of the period, from Henry VI's first outbreak of mental incapacity, a period of catatonic stupor, when he was unable to speak or move unaided, threw up a series of unstable governments, although the problem of domestic strife long predated his breakdown in 1453. The country was afflicted by private warfare between rival great families, itself a sign of their confidence that they could take advantage of an absence of firm government, with the skirmish between Percy's and Neville's at Haworth Moor in Yorkshire the first serious intermagnate clash of many. The aftermath of the humiliating loss of the king's last lands in France in 1450-53, leading to anger from those who had suffered from the restored Valois confiscations of the lands Henry V and VI had granted them there, or deplored the poor English military commitment and leadership, was tied in with resentment of the monopoly of patronage by a small faction around Henry VI in the 1440s. The most powerful magnate minister of this period and royal favourite, Michael de la Pole, Duke of Suffolk, was also held responsible for a lack of serious military commitment to Normandy, and blunders such as the failed appeasement that saw the surrender of Maine in 1448 and was impeached by Parliament and murdered in flight during the popular outbreak of 1450. But his political allies, led by the Beauforts under Edmund, Duke of Somerset, remained at the centre of a court party, who had strong personal support from the increasingly forceful young Queen Margaret, herself the symbol of Suffolk's failed rapprochement with Charles VII in 1444, the occasion of her marriage to Henry, and the partisan king. Edmund bore as much responsibility as Suffolk for the disasters in France, having been an unsuccessful governor of Maine in the early 1440s and overall commander in Normandy at the time of its reconquest in 1449-50, where his inaction and willingness to surrender were controversial. He and his late elder brother John, Marquess of Somerset, had diverted scarce English royal resources to their governorship of Maine at the time, when the Duke of York had been struggling to hold back the Valois advance in 1442-43, and John's Loire Valley expedition of 1443 had been a costly failure. Their uncle, Cardinal Beaufort, was the principal private financier of the defence of France and funded their campaigns. He was also more inclined to compromise in the failed Anglo-French peace talks than York's hard-line ally, Duke Humphrey of Gloucester. This seems to have soured relations between York and the Beauforts, adding to their dynastic rivalry as potential heirs to the childless King Henry. It should be noted that there was a marked similarity to the situation of the early 1320s and 1380s in official patronage in the 1440s, with a concentration of the grants of offices and lands on one small faction of senior courtiers, and with other figures, who were to be prominent in the violent reaction, as in 1326 and 1387 excluded. Suffolk, like his ancestor Michael de la Pole in 1385-86, and the Despensers in the early 1320s, seemed to have an unnatural grip on patronage and on the king's favour. The king was personally alienated from, and feared his excluded close relative and potential successors, Duke Humphrey to 1447, and then the Duke of York, as Edward II had feared the intentions of his Lancaster cousins, Earls Thomas and Henry, and as Richard II had feared John of Gaunt and his son, Henry of Bolingbroke. In all these cases, it was the king's natural advisers, his close relatives, who were excluded from influence and the benefits of patronage, although Henry VI did not go as far as Edward II, who executed Earl Thomas in 1322, and Richard II, who was accused of plotting to kill Gaunt in 1385-86, and again in 1398, and did kill his uncle Thomas of Gloucester in 1397. It was Suffolk and the Beauforts who were blamed for Duke Humphrey's sudden death while under arrest in 1447, though the king had arrested and ruined him first. The duke could be regarded as a martyr of Beaufort intrigue, one in a long line of honest senior royal relatives ruined by jealous court rivals such as Thomas of Lancaster and Thomas of Gloucester. His arrest and suspicious demise also warned York, already a prickly character, insistent on his rights, of what could happen to him if he let his guard slip. The idea of the Beauforts and Suffolk as a peace party, at odds with the hardline York in the 1440s, is, however, too simplistic, John and Edmund both fought hard, if incompetently, to defend their lands in Maine, and Edmund did not have the troops, money, or local Norman support to mount a vigorous defence of Normandy in 1450, though his passivity was still worthy of criticism. John and Suffolk had both fought in France back in Henry V's reign, and had been captured by the French, the former at Bourget, 1421, and the latter at Jargeau, 1429, and were not inexperienced civilian courtiers, and Suffolk's eagerness to negotiate and to surrender Maine in the mid-1440s was the king's personal, naive policy, not his alone. Arguably both Suffolk and Edmund Beaufort were defeatist, the first as a negotiator to hand Maine over without a fight, the latter, in his somnolence in Normandy in 1449-50, out of hard experience of French military strength, and York lacked their experience of defeat and captivity. For that matter, York had been as ruthless and militarily dilatory as John Beaufort in insisting that he had his requests for extensive legal power over his command in France granted before he sailed there, thus delaying a vital campaign, 1436. His attempt to induce the council to give him full viceregal powers then delayed his sailing until it was too late for him to coordinate his march in Normandy with Duke Humphrey's push southwards from Calais. In 1443, in a similar manner, John Beaufort did not sail for Normandy until August, due to haggling over his powers and his rewards, the latter to include a dukedom. He thus arrived too late for his planned march to the Loire and on to Bordeaux to drive Charles VII's army back in Gascony. Was York really so much more zealous and war-ready than his rivals in the crucial period of 1435-50? The latter were not unfairly traduced by him, however. The demands that John Beaufort made of the government in 1443 were outrageously venal. His brother Edmund was keen to secure his personal safety, not that of Normandy, as he surrendered Rouen in October 1449, and Suffolk undermined the king's finances in the 1440s by his wasteful administration. The fact that Charles VII pressed so relentlessly for the return of Maine in 1444-48, invaded it when the English broke their agreed surrender date in January 1448, and then raised more troops to attack Normandy within a year and a half, shows that if anyone was cozening the war-averse Henry in the 1440s, it was him, not a treacherous Suffolk. The fault equally lay with Henry for assuming that handing over Maine would satisfy him for years, rather than being regarded with contempt as a sign of weakness. The blame for the ignominious debacle in Maine in 1446-48 was, however, laid on Suffolk by York as early as 1447-49, and was extended when the king's chief negotiator and ex-treasurer, Bishop Molins of Chichester, hapless facilitator of the surrender, accused him in extremis as he was about to be lynched by angry soldiers in Portsmouth. The disaster in Normandy that followed was duly blamed on Suffolk by a furious parliament in winter 1449-50, and he was impeached, pardoned by the king but exiled, and was seized and executed as he fled at sea by vigilantes. The charges against Suffolk had included a paranoid but believable claim that he had betrothed his son to Margaret Beaufort, future mother of Henry VII and daughter of the late Marquess of Somerset, so that her claim to the throne could be used to make this couple Henry's heirs. The principal loser if this had occurred would have been York. So had York or his allies invented or backed up the charge? The hand of York might be seen behind the disgrace and death of Henry's trusted minister Suffolk, at least in Beaufort's eyes, and the events of early 1450 could thus add to the king's alienation from the duke. Marginalised senior royal relatives took the lead in the forcible removal of previous king's evil counsellors. Edward II's estranged wife and elder son were the leaders of the revolution of 1326-27. Richard's uncle Gloucester and cousin Henry of Bolingbroke were among the appellants in 1387. Henry removed Richard in 1399, and York was accused of suspicious encouragement to rebels in 1450, and defied the king in arms in 1451-52. So was it plausible for courtiers, or the king, to believe that York was aiming to emulate Henry of Bolingbroke? Or did the fact that a second arrested Duke of Gloucester had died mysteriously in custody in royal hands in 50 years, 1397 and 1447, exacerbate the problem that Humphrey's arrest had been meant to solve, that is, removing or intimidating the king's untrustworthy heirs? It is more likely that Humphrey died naturally than that he was poisoned, but that was not how contemporaries saw it, and arguably it lessened the chances that York would ever permit himself to be taken alive by the king's officials. Was Humphrey dead more dangerous than Humphrey alive, in increasing the chance of York defying the king with armed force? Was the real first act in the slide to civil war the Duke's arrest in 1447, neither the fall of Normandy nor the Cade Rebellion? Crucially for the future, Somerset, a personal foe of York by 1450, as shown by their repeated claims against each other, inherited Suffolk's role as Henry VI's most powerful magnate courtier after 1450, and was regarded as close to the Queen. He was rumoured to be the father of her son. His faction, in which the semi-royal Dukes of Buckingham and Exeter were prominent, continued to monopolise office and favour and exclude York, despite the threat posed by the latter's vast estates in the north and the Welsh marches. Genealogy and family tradition mattered a great deal in 15th-century noble politics, and Buckingham was the heir in the female Bouchier line of the executed Duke Thomas of Gloucester, and Exeter was the head of the Holland descendants of Richard II's loyal half-brothers, enemies of the usurper Henry of Bolingbroke. Both had a distant claim on the throne, and could be plausibly elevated to heirship if York was disinherited and the Beaufort claim was disallowed through illegitimacy, or the Beauforts could call on their alliance in joint enmity to the heirship front-runner York. There was, in effect, an alliance of the junior royal lines against the next line to Henry's, that of York, with Somerset representing the family of John of Gaunt by his third marriage. York united the lines of Edward III's second and fourth sons, Lionel and Edmund. He had inherited his mother, Anne Mortimer's extensive march of lands, and her claim to the throne via Edward III's second surviving son, Lionel. Richard II had recognised the march line as his heirs, and its descent via the female line was not an insuperable legal problem. After all, the English kings claimed the French throne by that means. This genealogical seniority to the House of Lancaster, descended from John of Gaunt, the third surviving son of Edward III, made York more of a threat than his father Richard, Earl of Cambridge, descended from the fourth son, Edmund of Langley, had been. The latter had already been executed in 1415 for plotting to murder Henry V before the Agincourt campaign. To add to the danger, York had made a name for himself as a reasonably successful military commander in Normandy in the early 1440s, unlike his successor, Somerset's older brother John Beaufort, and had opposed Suffolk's unsuccessful governorship and policy there. He was a magnet for returned captains and soldiers disgruntled at the inadequate support they had received from Suffolk's regime at home in the final years of Henry V's continental empire. The popular anger at this betrayal and its focus on Suffolk and his cronies as the villains was shown in Parliament and the Cade Revolt in 1449-50. Cade claimed to be from York's Mortimer family, so was he an ally of the Duke? The alienation of York, sent out of England by Suffolk's government to carry out the usually titular governance of Ireland in person in 1449, from the dominant faction at court, thus continued after Suffolk's death. Far from solving the conflicts by removing the perceived chief evil counsellor attacked in Parliament in 1450, the politically dangerous monopoliser of royal patronage, Suffolk's death only led to new problems. There were allegations at court that the exiled York had been behind the popular outbreaks of 1450, and that they were aimed at removing the childless Henry from the throne in his favour. The Cade rebels denied this. Whether or not this finally alienated the threatened Queen from York, the Duke was not trusted with any major office or role at court after his return from Ireland. Indeed, amidst the continuing factional confrontations, York's leading supporter, Sir William Oldhall, in trouble at court as a leader of parliamentary action against the Suffolk regime, was ostentatiously dragged out of sanctuary at St Martin's Le Grand in London by Somerset's men in a blatant sign of official ill will to the Duke. A first military confrontation between York's armed supporters and the King's occurred at Dartford in March 1542, though on this occasion, the greater numbers of the royal faction's troops enabled the mediating senior clerics to persuade York into a formal submission. The tension between court, magnate factions over the correct policy towards France was inevitable, and the disgrace of the loss of both Normandy and Aquitaine in 1450-53 led to Suffolk's enemies blaming him for incompetence or even deliberate sabotage of the English war effort. His attempt to win a long truce with Charles VII by the Anjou marriage and the goodwill abandonment of undefendable Maine in 1445-48 had been exploited by the French, who would return to the attack as soon as it was convenient, as was probably inevitable. But as far as Suffolk was concerned, the alternative was a financially exhaustive and politically risky long-term war, where failure could see overwhelming public demands for York's recall from Ireland to take command. Retrenchment at court would, however, have enabled more troops to be sent to Somerset's army in Normandy, giving him a better chance of holding out, and in 1448-50, court prodigality continued unabated. This was a major mistake by Suffolk, though cutting back would alienate his avaricious clients and threaten his power as well. The political storm that broke in 1449 was at a lower level than magnate criticism, being centred on Parliament in the first instance, with demands to sack and prosecute the corrupt ministers reminiscent of the Good Parliament in 1376, and then a violent popular outbreak. Indeed, Henry arguably made matters worse by not giving in and dismissing Suffolk at the first parliamentary demands in July 1449, at a time when he still held Normandy, and the blackmailing MPs were prepared to fund a new army if he sacked Suffolk, which would have helped to raise a larger army than was actually gathered in winter 1449-50. This might have held on to Normandy, at least in the short term. Long-term defence of the open frontier and the walled towns against Charles VII's large army and artillery was unlikely. Instead, Henry dismissed Parliament and had no money to pay for reinforcing Normandy in autumn 1449, and the French invasion proceeded with only a small English expedition under a minor captain, Sir Thomas Kiriel, not the capable and popular York, to try to halt it. The King's failed gamble on dismissing Parliament to save his chief minister, then having to call a new one in less favourable circumstances later, is reminiscent of Charles I's actions with the short Parliament in 1640. To that extent, Henry bore major responsibility for the debacle in Normandy in 1449-50, as he did for vainly writing admiring letters to his hostile uncle Charles VII in the mid-1440s, assuring his goodwill and promising to hand over Maine by a certain date when he could not be sure this would be practicable. What if his local garrison commanders refused to do it? In reality, Henry was as guilty as Suffolk of naivety and incompetence in his French policy of the 1440s, and his extravagant expenditure at court made his ability to raise armies less possible. The Cade Revolt, as in 1381, focused on Kent and led to a march on London and lynch law by the armed protesters in the streets. Henry, unlike Richard II in 1381, hid in the Midlands. The extent of the anger and violence seems to have been unexpected, and probably Suffolk was too preoccupied with the danger from dissident magnates of royal blood, which the Crown had faced in 1387-88 and 1399, a problem seemingly warded off by sending York to Ireland. The popular anger was bound to focus on Suffolk, given his visible monopoly of patronage and policy. But this raises the question of why an adult king had allowed one minister such a free rein, and thus Henry's culpability for the crisis. Already in the 1440s, the evidence of popular rumour, recorded in the chronicles of Harding and Capgrave, spoke of Henry being scorned by his most outspoken subjects as a simpleton. The probability is that he was easily led by unscrupulous courtiers into giving them excessive grants, rather than judiciously buying support from a wider constituency. The likely fate for a king who had such an unbalanced use of patronage had been seen in the fall of the over-rewarded and recklessly greedy Despensers in 1326, and of Suffolk's ancestor Michael de la Pole in 1386, if not the grants Richard II had made to his favourites, a somewhat wider circle in 1397-99. Henry thus neglected his first duty as a political leader, and his generous grants to his favourite projects, such as King's College, Cambridge, can also be seen in the light of reckless favouritism rather than of piety alone. The land grants that Henry had been making since his effective majority, 1437, were subject to a sweeping review and cancellation by Parliament in the early 1450s, an indictment of nationwide perceptions of their fair distribution of assets among the landed gentry and nobles. Like Edward II and Richard II, the king was perceived to be the tool of a greedy and politically disastrous faction. But it is clear that Edward and Richard both asserted themselves after their political defeats, 1310 and 1387-88, in angry retaliation against those who had constrained them. The executions of ex-rebel Thomas of Lancaster in 1322 and of some of the Lords Appellant in 1397 were the king's work, though encouraged by their ultra-supporters. In Henry's case, his personal role in the reaction in the 1450s is absent, at least from the time of his mental collapse in 1453. This helped to save his reputation in subsequent decades, and he became known posthumously as a saintly fool, not a villain, though it should be pointed out that any evidence of this attitude in post-1485 works may have been influenced by his nephew Henry VII's propaganda efforts to have him canonised. Henry VI's unwillingness to see the necessity of balancing grants among different factions at court was coupled with an undoubted political reliance on one group of lords. The latter were confident enough of his support, or his indifference to injustice, to abuse their power and manipulate local politics for their own benefit. Significantly, the major disturbances of 1449-50 broke out in areas under the dominance of Henry's favourite ministers, the beneficiaries of his lavish patronage: Suffolk in East Anglia, Lord Treasurer Fiennes in Kent and Sussex, and Bishop Iscough in Wiltshire. All of these men, Suffolk in particular, had a collection of offices and grants of royal lands in their regions unprecedented for generations. The last such political monopolists had been the favourites of another weak king, Edward II's Despenser allies, who met a similarly grisly fate at the hands of their enemies when overthrown. Their local leadership of society had been delegated to their clients in their absence at court, and the latter were abusing the processes of government and justice without any prospect that the king would intervene. As in 1326, 1387 and 1399, the king was seen to be partisan and not carrying out his duty to see justice imposed, and the victims ended up by taking revenge themselves. This anarchy of local armed feuding was underway well before the explosion of anger caused by the loss of Maine and Normandy in 1448-50, and so had other causes. It also preceded the return of soldiers from the evacuated lands in France, and so was not due to unemployed soldiers or ruffianly retainers used to having their way by force. The infamous and long-running feud of the Courtenays and Bonvilles in Devon was descending into armed clashes as early as 1440-41. Henry's lack of discrimination or common sense in his lavish generosity with grants of crown lands and local offices were complained of at the time in the 1440s, and were later indicted by Lord Chief Justice Fortescue as an example of how not to run a just and successful government. To that extent, the monopoly of royal favour and receipt of grants by the Suffolk-Beaufort faction in the 1440s was both a reason for and a result of the young king's naive ineptitude, and it reflected his insecurity about his potential heirs, Humphrey and then York, who were the main political alternatives as his senior advisers. The early death of Henry's elder uncle John, Duke of Bedford, aged 46 in September 1435, was thus a political disaster, as he had held the ring between Humphrey and the Beauforts in their power struggles since 1422. Had he been alive in the 1440s, he might have been still in office as Lieutenant of Normandy. His regency there would have lapsed on Henry's majority in 1437, and so been unable to rein in the king's extravagance and reliance on venal courtiers. But if he had been back in England, Suffolk's and the Beauforts' misrule would have been less likely, and so a violent parliamentary purge and popular revolt in 1450 have been averted? Would this have lessened Henry's estrangement from York? It would also have meant that Bedford's widow, Jaquetta of St. Paul, would have been unavailable to marry Sir Richard Woodville, meaning that York's controversial daughter-in-law-to-be, Elizabeth Woodville, was never born. Henry VI was not the first king to act with injustice and suspicion towards his relatives, and ambitious courtiers were always ready to accuse a monarch's kin of treason with the hope of obtaining their confiscated lands and offices. But it is symptomatic that those kings who listened to and acted on such stories were the ones who were later accused of bad governance and placed under restraint or overthrown: Henry III, Edward II, and Richard II. Even Henry V had accused his stepmother, Joan of Navarre, of witchcraft on uncertain evidence, imprisoned her, and seized her property, the main reason for the prosecution. But she was allowed respectable accommodation while in disgrace, Leeds Castle, and eventually exonerated. Duke Humphrey's second wife, Eleanor Cobham, similarly accused of plotting to kill the king, was condemned, divorced, and deported to the Isle of Man for life, possibly due to a Beaufort plot to ensure that she did not give Humphrey any heirs to challenge them for the succession. Humphrey was not guiltless in his alienation from the king in the early 1440s, having been threatening Cardinal Beaufort with violence and/or political ruin for 2 decades, and had been conspicuous for his petulant disloyalty to Bedford in the 1420s. He had been opposing the king's conciliatory French policy noisily in recent years, but proceeding to the extreme of arresting him was politically unwise. Crucially, Humphrey had had no children either by Eleanor or by his first wife, Jacqueline of Holland. Due to the papal ruling confirming the latter's disputed first marriage, regarded as void by her and Humphrey in 1428, Humphrey's children by her would have been bastardized. But any children Humphrey had had by Eleanor would have been next in line for the throne in 1447-53, and the Suffolk faction would duly have feared them, not York, as the reversionary interest. Henry's responsibility for the disasters of 1440s, not a holy fool. Henry used to be regarded as ultra-pious, even before his illness in 1453, influenced by his prudish religiosity and his foundation of King's College, Cambridge. Thus, the blame for the disastrous policies of the 1440s could be placed on an unscrupulous Suffolk, whose greed, incompetence, and acquisition of offices and lands were listed in the hostile 1450 Parliament. Even that implied that Henry was too open to the influence of unscrupulous advisers, while absolving him from the active part in ministerial misrule laid against Richard II. The requirement of Parliament, after Suffolk's fall, that all royal grants of crown lands during his adult reign be resumed, that is, cancelled, need not imply that he had committed these controversial alienations to unworthy favourites as a conscious policy. Excessive generosity also marked his attitude towards his educational projects. But has his later simpleton reputation, after his 1453 breakdown, been backdated to the period before his illness? It is now thought by historians such as Bertram Wolfe that he played a more active role in the diversion of influence and patronage to the Suffolk faction than was once thought. The records show that he made his rash of lavish grants to 1440s courtiers and their clients in person, many being politically unwise, and was requested to reverse some at the time. The king was in full possession of his faculties, and showed signs of spendthrift habits. His favouritism was notable. At the very least, he showed a degree of political incompetence in his lack of even-handedness, and was overwilling to lavish power and influence on a small group of congenial advisers. Like Edward II and Richard II, he had no concept of the political need for balance or for wooing powerful nobles whom his personal friends disliked. The contrast with his father, his uncle Bedford, and paternal grandfather is notable. So is his complete lack of interest in taking up the family cause of fighting for his French crown, though he was a crowned sovereign of France, unlike his ancestors. His response to the rising disasters after 1429 is marked, and in contrast to what was normally expected of an English king, and would have been expected of him, as he had had the usual knightly military training in arms under the veteran Earl of Warwick as a teenager. He was no pacifist at this stage, being prepared to endorse a large-scale military campaign by his court favourite, Somerset, to the Loire in 1443 to secure his lands, though after that he naively put faith in the goodwill of his uncle and new uncle-in-law, Charles VII, in 1444-48. In this crucial period, he also showed no interest in negotiating from strength, not building up his forces ready for a potential military clash if the peace policy failed as Charles was doing. It is probable that he entirely misread Charles' intentions, putting his faith naively in a projected meeting between them set for 1446-47, which never took place, and where his politically shrewd and unscrupulous counterpart would have run rings round him. Instead, he instituted a secret negotiation with Charles via his episcopal diplomats, led by Bishops Molins and Ayscough, and in modern parlance, left out of the loop his experienced commanders in France, for example York, who would have been hostile, but at least knew the local military situation. He even privately promised to hand over Maine in December 1445 without any clear guarantees of an end to French claims on Normandy in return. The entire concept of a reverse dowry, land being given by the husband to his wife's family, not the other way around, on his marriage in 1445 was unusual, though evidently judged worthwhile to secure a truce after the failure of the Somerset offensive in 1443. But Henry and his bishops did not appreciate that the whole lesson of French revival, since 1429, was the ultimate power of military force. Duke Philip had stayed with his English allies until the tide of battle decisively turned, and Bedford was dying, then shamelessly violated his oath to Henry as King of France. Negotiating from weakness would earn Charles contempt, not his respect, and in due course he resumed the war and took over Maine, and then Normandy, once his new army was ready. Henry was inflexible on refusing to give up the claim to France, which Charles had made clear in the Gravelines talks of 1439 was his sine qua non, but hopeless at accepting the political and military implications of what that refusal entailed. At least after Somerset's failure and death in 1443-44, he had no senior semi-royal commander adequate to the task of fighting and loyal to his policies, apart from possibly Somerset's younger brother Edmund, a competent local commander in the south of Normandy. Henry reportedly wept at the betrayal by his greatest vassal, Duke Philip, in 1435, and he hesitated over handing over Maine after 1445, possibly for fear that his furious local commanders would refuse to carry it out. In the event, the latter were still uncertain of government intentions and without direction when Charles invaded in March 1448 and had to negotiate their surrender on their own initiative to stop a massacre. But Henry neither sought to fight in person nor put trust in his most competent and vigorous commander, York. The latter, like equally persona non grata Duke Humphrey before 1447, was studiously ignored on his return to England for the 1445 Parliament, was neither given an extension of his governorship nor superseded in Normandy for many vital months, and was eventually sent off to Ireland in semi-disgrace. In fact, Ireland was a logical field to use his military skills, and he had a stake there due to inheriting Mortimer lands. But did his absence from England in 1450 enable enemies, Somerset, to undermine him at court more easily? If he had been in England and helping Henry against the Cade rebels, would he have lost the king's trust as he did? York could have been expected to be hostile to Henry's timid policy towards Charles VII, not least as his years in Normandy and his many military contacts warned him of a continuing French build-up. As he saw matters accurately, Charles was only playing for time in the mid-1440s, not seeking a permanent settlement that left England with Normandy. As seen from court, England could not afford the level of military spending that would raise enough troops to dissuade Charles from attacking. It would also require undesirable cuts to the king and his new queen's spending, risking their wrath with those who suggested this. But there is no evidence that the king, or his more forceful pro-peace ministers, led by Suffolk, ever sought to explain their rationale to York or to win him round. On the contrary, York was treated with suspicion as the politically dangerous leader of the opposition to war and ministers alike, increasing the risk of the feared clash occurring. Crucially, securing enough troops and money from the political nation in Parliament for a more vigorous policy in France after 1444 would have required a degree of honesty and seeking collaboration with elite across the nation that the government clearly avoided for its own security. As seen by Parliament's demands in July 1449, the MPs would have wanted Suffolk to be sacked. Logically, raising funds would need a Parliament, on a wider basis than the carefully controlled and partisan one that met in February 1447, with the resulting danger of demands for reform of abuses. There would be a danger to the monopoly of power and patronage by Suffolk and the Beauforts, and their allies such as Lord Fiennes. Either Humphrey, or, once he was dead, York could be expected to demand more influence and patronage, if not Suffolk's instant dismissal, in return for any cooperation. Disputed offices and lands would have to be returned to Suffolk's opponents in the localities, which would build up the client base of men he feared. It is probable that York's enemies actively blackened his name to the timid king, building him up as a potential rebel. Denied access to court after his return in 1445, York was left to brood in what amounted to disgrace, despite the supposed honour of his command in Ireland, with his political allies denied lands or office, which mattered a great deal to a proud magnate in an era when a lord was supposed to secure patronage for his clients. This obviously increased the risks of a backlash from the affronted duke, as it had done for similarly alienated royal magnates, Duke Thomas of Gloucester and Henry of Bolingbroke, towards Richard II with the 1387 revolt. Suffolk, and after his return from Normandy on its loss in 1450, Edmund Beaufort, had the political experience and skill to appreciate this if the naive king did not. It would seem that the lust of the Suffolk clique, allied to the Beauforts for monopolising office and land grants in the 1440s, added to the king's fear of Humphrey and York as potential rebels to repeat the disastrous political confrontation of the 1380s. But would York have been feared by the king anyway, without the use of his name made by the Cade rebels in 1450? Was he, as presumed rival heir, an inevitable target for Somerset, or the Queen? Or was this the turning point for his reputation? The French disaster from 1448 to 50, for which Suffolk was publicly blamed, added humiliation to political frustration and rising disorder, and produced a massive explosion of public hatred in the risings of winter 1449 to 50, many, significantly, in areas of court favourites' political dominance. Demands were made in 1450 that Henry replace these men with the group of senior lords of royal blood, who were unjustly denied influence, headed by the Dukes of York, Buckingham, descendant of Edward III's youngest son, and Norfolk and Exeter, descendants of Edward I's youngest sons. This was similar to the charges of favouritism that could be levelled at Edward II and Richard II, and to a degree, against Henry III, none of whom were to be remembered as saintly simpletons not responsible for the chaos their favouritism unleashed. In their cases, it was their victims, Simon de Montfort in 1265, Thomas of Lancaster in 1322, and the Earl of Arundel in 1397, who acquired a popular cult as martyrs. Henry's mental breakdown thus did his subsequent and posthumous reputation a lot of good, though it helped that he could never be plausibly charged with unsavoury homosexual practices, as were Edward and Richard. He could even be suggested as a possible saint by his nephew Henry VII, once he had been dead for 2 decades, and memories of his incompetence were fading. Arguably the continuance of political faction after his overthrow in 1461, leading to his successor's removal in 1470, aided his reputation by showing that national unity had not returned under his replacement after his deposition. As it did, after a few years' serious turbulence after 1327 and 1399. As suggested before, Henry VII also promoted the idea that his uncle had not been personally responsible for the disasters of the 1450s, as he sought to have him canonised. Chapter 2. The Yorkist Reaction, from control in 1453 to deposition in 1461. Inevitable? 1. The opportunities offered by the King's madness. The road to St. Albans, 1452 to 55. The onset of the King's mysterious mental collapse in early August 1453 was completely unexpected and caused a radical reversal of politics, rather than being an inevitable follow-up to his problems in the late 1440s. He had given no previous sign of serious ill health, as opposed to being rash, extravagant, unmilitary, and easily manipulated by his advisers. Despite the evidence of scurrilous public remarks about his being weak-minded, there had been no serious attempt to depose him after the overseas humiliations and poor domestic government of the late 1440s. Indeed, the nebulous Mortimer claims during the Cade Revolt and hints that York was the rightful king were subsequently denounced in terms of outrage in reasonably representative meetings of lords and commons after 1450. One MP in 1451, York's ex-attorney, Young, had formally proposed York as heir. York had been abroad then, but it was logical for his foes to think he had approved, and York's tenants had been involved in rioting. The loss of Normandy and Aquitaine in 1450-52 was met by a determined effort on the part of the political elite to regain them, rather than just a search for a scapegoat, and in any case, Suffolk's violent death had served to satisfy the latter demand, though it probably also emboldened would-be anti-court vigilantes. In 1452, the veteran royal commander Shrewsbury led an expedition to regain Bordeaux, and the subsequent parliament at Reading, March 1453, made massive financial grants to the king for a follow-up expedition of 20,000 archers. Tonnage and poundage were granted to Henry for life, only the second such grant since 1399. The archers, England's best military weapon against the numerically superior French, were to be given 4 months' notice to assemble at the ports and then be paid for 6 months' service overseas. This would enable an Agincourt-sized expedition, and Henry was expected to lead it in person, as hoped for in the Book of Noblesse by his general Sir John Fostolf's secretary, William Worcester. Despite Henry's past failure to fight or to pay an expedition adequately, there was evident goodwill among the political nation for a new beginning and a major effort to reverse recent disasters. Many MPs can perhaps be written off as trustees carefully selected by pro-court patrons, as there were complaints about the Commons being full of royal household men. The same cannot be said of the peers, almost all of whom attended. If Henry had led his nobles to war, would it have rallied malcontents behind the king, as in 1415, or shown his lack of leadership skills? At this point, it was York, not Henry or Somerset, who seemed politically isolated. He had behaved, with some excuse, like a man under threat of destruction by his ill wishers at court in early 1452, issuing a belligerent manifesto from his headquarters at Ludlow Castle on the 9th of January, claiming that the king's mistrust was due to the influence of his enemies, and then summoning his supporters to join him in a march on London. He complained that his advice to Henry at an interview at Westminster on the 6th of October 1450 to do justice on those accused of misrule by the Commons, that is, York's enemies, headed by Somerset, had been ignored to the resultant damage of the realm, and that he was to be accused of treason and his family disinherited. When he sent these letters and then marched on London in February, he was aware of Henry's refusal to back down, which the royal letters patent of the 17th of February, calling on all loyal subjects to rally to the king in arms, confirmed. He was thus guilty of fully intentional defiance of his sovereign by armed intimidation on this occasion, though the subsequent royalist claim in 1459 that he had previously forced his way into Henry's presence past his guards at Westminster in September 1450 cannot be proven. Luckily for the king, York's supporters at their rendezvous on Dartford Heath, 10 to 20,000, were outnumbered by Henry's by 3 to 1, according to Abbot Wheathampstead of St. Albans. he had to submit to coming to the king's camp, where he vainly presented a list of charges against Somerset to Henry, and a few days later swore an oath of allegiance to him at St. Paul's Cathedral, and promised never again to raise an army against the king. So far, York had been the aggressor, though some of his charges against Somerset, over the attack on Fougeray, which provoked Charles VII's final invasion and the surrender of Rouen, were based on truth. It was, however, symptomatic that there was no politic generosity towards York by the supposedly holy king. He had used a progress through York's marcher lands in 1452 not to display forgiveness to his errant subjects, but hold judicial tribunals for ex-rebels and require miscreants to appear before him wearing halters to beg pardon, not even staying with York when he visited the Duke's principal residence at Ludlow, an evident snub. He also endeavoured to hand over a disputed part of the Despenser inheritance in Glamorgan from York's nephew and ally, the Neville Earl of Warwick, who held it by fully legal worship, to rival claimant Somerset. Warwick was refusing to obey, and holding on to the disputed castles, while in the north another armed magnate dispute saw his relation Sir John Neville fighting the pro-Beaufort Percy cadet, Lord Egremont. It was while on progress in the West Country, rather than preparing for his promised expedition, that Henry suffered his mental collapse. His recent official references to his wife's uncle Charles VII had been unusually bitter, suggesting that the king was in a belligerent and vengeful mood towards France, and the royal ally, Cardinal Kemp, a 1440s peacemaker, vigorously denounced French cunning and treachery in the 1440s as he issued official prayers for military success. A planned expedition for 1453 to 54 thus seems genuine, rather than an excuse to raise an army to attack the Duke of York. Possibly, if Henry's health had not declined, he would have been resentful enough at his French uncle's duplicity to lead a campaign in Normandy in 1454, though his character and total lack of martial ability would indicate that he would have had to rely heavily on his senior commanders, including York. Any such expedition would have been a blow to his future hagiography as a holy peacemaker, as played up by Shakespeare in his plays. But as of 1453, he had no reputation as a would-be saint, and it is logical that he would have seen his betrayal by the French as justifying the war. The shock of actually witnessing the battle in person at St. Albans in 1455 may have given him another mental breakdown, but is no indication that this would have happened in a stressful situation as he was leading his army in France. A sudden shock while on active service had, however, driven his grandfather Charles VI of France insane in 1392, so it cannot be ruled out. If Henry genuinely intended to lead an expedition, there was no sign of its imminence as he suffered his sudden illness in Wiltshire, and his collapse paralysed the government, which depended ultimately on personal leadership by the sovereign. The timetable of events was such that Shrewsbury's defeat and death at Castillon, and the second loss of Bordeaux, meant that any expedition would now have to reconquer the city again. But this was perfectly feasible with such a large army. The king's illness may have prevented a campaign to reconquer Aquitaine in 1454, presumably led by the experienced Somerset, as the latter's faction, and apparently the queen, irrevocably distrusted York. The government and the well-armed peers would then have been concentrating on France, not on civil strife, and the sense of national unity in a 1415-style patriotic war have reacted to Henry's benefit. But there must still be a possibility that the rising tide of Neville versus Percy armed clashes in Yorkshire, with a pitched inter-family battle at Heworth on the 24th of August, would have distracted Somerset into a domestic expedition of revenge against his faction's enemies. The king's first mental collapse in 1453 led to him spending months in a catatonic state, unable to speak or move, and being kept in seclusion away from the London area, mostly at Clarendon near Salisbury, where the illness began in August 1453. At the time, shock at the news of the final English defeat in Aquitaine at Castillon was supposed to be the likeliest cause. Losing the last of his ancestral continental possessions but for Calais was a profound humiliation and could have stimulated a depressive stupor. The main symptoms of his illness were complete loss of awareness and movement. By contrast, His maternal grandfather, Charles VI's mental illness, had involved delusions and bouts of violence. As the next legal adult heir, York assumed the regency as King's lieutenant to open the next parliament by request of the council, as it became apparent that feuding great lords, particularly in the north, were taking advantage of the lapse in personal royal rule to wage private war. Rather than seeking reconciliation with his foes and broadening his support as the government was paralysed, he was still issuing bitter complaints about Somerset. Ironically, the birth of a son to Henry and Margaret in the interim, in October, meant that York was no longer heir apparent and so would not take the throne if Henry died, which may have induced his fearful enemies, led by Somerset, to go along with granting him regency powers. To make matters worse, Archbishop and Lord Chancellor Kemp died on the 22nd of March, so there was no official licensed to operate the Great Seal and legalise administrative measures, and the catatonic Henry could not appoint or approve a successor. York had not endeared himself to Parliament by his vindictive arrest of its Speaker, Thomas Thorpe, a personal foe, but there was no other option but to grant him the power to run the government if chaos was to be avoided. On the 27th, he was named as Protector of the Realm, like Duke Humphrey, military leader and first among equals on the council, but not regent. York led the council, minus the arrested Somerset, until Henry was demonstrably capable again in early 1455. His monopoly of power meant the inevitable dismissal of his rivals from office to secure control for his nominees, but he made no attempt to come to an agreement with Somerset and used his power to place the latter in the Tower. This escalated the already toxic distrust of Beauforts and allies for the York faction, and once Henry regained his senses, they arranged the dismissal of York's appointees, led by his brother-in-law, the Lord Chancellor, the Earl of Salisbury, and a formal absolution of Somerset from all charges. Somerset's ally Exeter, who had been arrested by York in summer 1454 for assembling an armed force in Yorkshire, and claiming that he should be both Duke of Lancaster, as a descendant of Elizabeth, the daughter of John of Gaunt, and the rightful protector during Henry's incapacity, was released from custody, and the accusations made against him declared groundless. This was legally dubious, as Exeter had been defying the legally appointed protector by armed revolt, and so was as guilty as York had been in 1452. Exeter was a close ally of the Percys, and had been disputing the inheritance of some of Elizabeth of Lancaster's estates with the pro-York Lord Cromwell, whose daughter was married to Salisbury's son. York and Somerset were bound over to keep the peace until their disputes were to be resolved in June. The Duke's withdrawal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.